I think Twitter uses a Periscope, I think, is it?
There is a new one now, Space, that is quite interesting. Yes. Technology has changed the world.
Well, it really has. It really has changed. And that one can be talking to multiple people simultaneously, multiple platforms at once.
Yes, and our discussion tonight, anyway, is about technology.
Exactly. That is it. Exactly. I still can't see Adamu. Adamu, please, if you're here, Adamu Gaba, if you're here with any device name, can you quickly indicate by using the raise hand, you know, option to indicate, because I can't see you unless you come, you came in with a different name, and that same thing applies to Desa Mamadi. If you're here, you know, it's a very relaxed conversation, basically, so people shouldn't worry. Adam, if you're here, please. Okay, let me quickly try him on the phone. Because I think we will have to start, and we will be going live now, you know, from my end here. So once they join us, then wherever they meet us, then that's fine. So we can no longer wait, you know. I do understand and I appreciate that the short notice, you know, is not easy. I understand that everyone is busy. So once more, welcome. Everybody, my name is Mazi. Okay, welcome to NNAMDI'S Media TV. And the topic today, as it says in the message that went out, the topic goes, is Buhari's tweet to deal with those misbehaving in the language they understand a threat to Ndibo? The story started yesterday, around 5 o'clock in the evening. People started seeing the tweet and many people started reacting. That the president of Nigeria, in a reaction to the death of Ahmed Gulak, the burning of INEC properties in the southeast, the obviously with other properties, we've seen hotels, we've seen police formations being destroyed, and to this date, no one can actually say clearly who is behind all this. In that tweet, the president said that he would indeed support INEC to do whatever that is needed to do, that he is not willing to stay beyond the needed time or beyond his tenure in office. Basically, that tweet yesterday was a series of tweets in a thread. But one part of that tweet is the one that caught people's attention, that have made many people to react in the manner they are reacting now. Now, to have this conversation this evening, I have here, I would say that it is a privilege to have amongst us Chief DELE MOMODU, who is the CEO, publisher of Ovation International. Chief DELE, I bow to you. I say good evening and welcome to this conversation.
Good evening, my dear friend and brother Mazi. How are you?
I'm doing all right, sir.
Good.
And
good.
Again, I must thank you for agreeing to join even within the shortest period, you know, notice. I mean, it is an honor that I reached out within the shortest notice and you agreed to join this conversation. It is a privilege. And I must once more say thank you to you. Thank you.
No, Mazi, is it okay? You know, we are forever together. I respect you a lot. I love your composure. I love your work. I love the quality of everything about you. You are a fine gentleman.
Thank you very much. Now I feel flattered. I can begin to blush like a woman.
Please feel free to blush. Today is not a day for modesty.
Thank you very much. So, having said that, I think I have, Sam, Dr. Sam Amadi, I think I can see a device named Sam. If that's you, can you quickly unmute and turn on your camera?
All right, I'm trying to get loads. Did you know, quick.
So I can't don't worry. Okay, don't worry.
Doctor, you can't do that alone. We must join you.
Thank you.
Yes, sir.
Don't turn on your camera yet. Thank you very much. So, okay, so we have two of you now. For some reason, I'm yet to still see Adamu Gaba here. So, Adamu, if you're here, please kindly raise your, if you're here and not with your device name, can you quickly please let me know so that I can bring you in. And my second guest this evening, as I said, is Dr. Sam Amadi, who is a senior lecturer and head of department at Bayes University. For many of you who may be aware, or some may not, Sam Amadi was a governorship candidate in the last governorship election in Imo State. Now, it is a privilege to have you here also. And once more, Dede, I will say thank you for agreeing within the short notice also to join this conversation this evening. I understand, they say. Obviously, he's trying to sort himself out. So let's get the ball rolling. I'll start with Chief DELE MOMODU here. Obviously, I see that you tweeted that tweet from the president. And when you tweeted it, you said nothing. You only added exclamation marks. So what do we need to understand by that exclamation mark that you added to that tweet?
Well, I didn't see the tweet as soon as it was tweeted by whoever was tweeting for President Buhari, because I don't believe he tweets himself, so he has his handlers. But apparently the tweet came from a speech he made earlier on to the INEC officials in his office. A friend had alerted me to it to ask, could this be true? And since I didn't know, so I quickly rushed to the Twitter page of President Buhari, the verified Twitter page, because I had to be doubly sure that it was real. And so I scrolled down, and I saw that particular offensive tweet. And so I quickly responded to my friend that it is very true. But I was too shocked, too stupefied, too dazed to write my usual comment. So that's why I had to use the exclamation marks, three exclamation marks. So the message I was sending out was, wow, wow, wow. This is the lowest of the lowest that we could get when a president and commander-in-chief threatens a section of the country directly, without missing words. No matter the degree of provocation, I'm not saying he has no right to be provoked. I'm not saying he has no right to be frustrated with the insecurity in Nigeria. But to now remind us of the civil war that claimed millions of lives, I think that was an all-time low. And that was what made me to put the exclamation marks. There was nothing to say. There was nothing to add to it. And I'm not surprised about the response from across the world. People called me from everywhere saying, ah, Dele, we know you were one of the supporters of Buhari. Every day people abuse me. Anyway, I'm used to it now. Oh, you people brought this pestilence onto Nigeria and all that. They abused us. They attack us every day. I'm used to it. There are some I apologize to, some I get angry and I say, I didn't force you to vote for Buhari, so stop harassing my life. But the truth is, I was horrified yesterday.
Thank you very much for that quick response. So I do not know if Sam Amadi is ready. If you are, please quickly indicate. But if I come back to that tweet, you know, that tweet has, you know, gotten some reactions, quite all right, as you said. But at the same time, that tweet, equally, there are some that have obviously defended it. The reason why I brought in, you know, Gaba here today, but sadly I could not appear to see him, even when we agreed 7 o'clock. Gaba made a statement where he tried making a distinction, saying that that tweet was directed to Ipob, not the great Igbo nation. What would be your reaction to that statement from Gaba?
Is that for me or for Doctor?
Yes, because obviously...
Okay, Doctor is still busy. Okay. Oh, wow. For me, there is no difference between IPOB and Indigo. So the fact that... And I will tell you why. I once experienced a bombing in London by the IRA, the Irish Republican Army, when they were fighting for freedom. And they used to throw bombs all across London. And then they had a political wing, which was the Sinn Féin. I'm sure you remember the history of that very, very, very tough moment in English history. So they were throwing bombs all around, but I never heard any prime minister, I think maybe Tony Blair was the prime minister there, I never heard them say, we are going to bomb everybody. We are going to, you know, deal with them in a language that they will understand. They kept dialoguing. You never get tired of dialoguing. Even if you are going to use carrot and sticks, you don't come out on live television. Live television. And say, I'm going to deal with them sooner than later. In fact, there is even like a deadline to it, that very soon I'm going to clamp down. And, you know, and even IPOB have monitored a lot of their broadcasts. They denied some of these things. Do you understand? So which means that they are not as overtly radical as they used to be. Because a lot of people are also talking to them. Government should never get tired of talking to people. A lot of people are talking to them and say no. I remember, for example, when the NSAS movement thing happened in Lagos and there was a broadcast purportedly from Mazi NNAMDI'S Kanu that they should attack some people in Lagos and all that. Later he came out and he said, he regretted it. And so in life, the same way the president is frustrated, that's the same way that some people in Indigo are very frustrated with the nation called Nigeria. So it would be much better if the president can continue to dialogue, especially with the leadership of Indigo, to say, look, we want you to intervene. You see, people would not have been angry yesterday about what the president said if they heard him say the same thing about the bandits, about the terrorists. Till today, I've never heard anybody in the presidency label what is happening, especially in the northern parts, where I feel for my brothers and sisters in the north. Every day you hear 300 people have been kidnapped, students have been kidnapped, people have been, you know, and people are living in fear. They are living in trepidation. And I've never heard the president threaten them in the same manner. I think that is why people reacted that way. If, for example, when he was talking, he said, oh, we're going to deal with the general insecurity all the bad people in Nigeria, all the evil people in Nigeria who want to ruin Nigeria, who want to destroy our country, I'm going to clamp down on them. That would have been different. But when you say some of us who fought for 30 months or whatever, that we are ready to do the same thing. What is an open declaration of war again? So people were really, really aghast and alarmed that the president could say that publicly.
Okay, thank you very much. I mean, let me, for the benefit of those who probably be watching now and who may not know the tweet in question or who may not even have read it, here we have it on the screen. And here he says, many of those misbehaving today are too young to be aware of the destruction and loss of lives that occurred during the Nigerian Civil War. Those of us in the fields for 30 months who went through the war, we treat them, again, underline that word them, in the language they do understand. Now, Dey Samamadi, welcome to this conversation, and thank you for joining us. Now, reading these tweets, as an Ipo leader of thought, what is going through your mind?
Okay, thank you very much, and thank you. I think I would have Dele set it up properly. Two quick things, if you look at it clearly, the choice of maybe, to give the benefit of doubt, even of that, he wanted to communicate, we are ready to take the battle to whoever it takes. But when you go through history, when you speak in the imagery of history, you should be very careful. So when he invoked the Civil War, which ended, whose memorial was a few days, 2 days ago, a civil war that is classified as genocidal, that led to several deaths, and then you say that those of us who involved in the field of that war, teach them a lesson in the language. Now, I'm doing like a communication, I teach legal writing, so let me do it like a communication expert, analyze it. Teach them a lesson in the language they understand. First, who are they? Those of them who forgot, or who are making trouble, who are part or offsprings of that Biafran war, which language do they understand? The language of mass violence, which we use against them. So anybody who write me the message, see invocation of the imagery of genocide against a people. So it's below Mr. President, that's the mistake. He should have, if he says, look, we fought a dangerous war that cost life. We don't want to go that way again. I want to warn all these miscreants, all these criminals, blah, 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 who have not experienced this war and therefore didn't want to go to. Please don't lead us into war. We will make sure we don't have insecurity in this country by drastically dealing with these people. So you are not invoking the imagery. And considering the president himself was a prime participant in that war. And now saying those of us who fought that war that led to the deaths of millions, we will speak to you in the language you people understand, which is the language of destruction, vanquish, that's really the analysis you can give to that speech. So it's sad. It could be a Freudian slip. Somebody can construct as a Freudian slip, meaning that this is probably the president's disposition. And so in a moment of indiscretion speaking, it slips out, which makes it even more frightening that your government could actually harbor genocidal impulses. Or if you don't even go that far, I say this is mere irresponsibility or lack of wisdom, there is also frightening that the president of a country that's in this state of insecurity, with this kind of crisis, could be absent-minded to that degree of not understanding the implication of those tweets. So either way, it's very dangerous. It doesn't speak of trust in the moral quality of the presidency or the president. And this is very important. Everybody who's a president of a country that's facing crisis like Nigeria is an unenviable position. We sympathize with the president because it's really a crazy time in Nigeria. So I can understand a president who is exasperated. I can understand a president who is worried that look at Boko Haram almost overrunning the north, inching to Abuja. Look at the south that used to be the most peaceful. Now the stable of unknown government, violence pyramid. So the president is rightly need to be worried and probably needs to speak tough. But he shouldn't speak tough in a language that evokes this group violence, mass violence against the people. And again, if you consider it in the context of the IG's directives, the president alleged destruction, deal with anybody. It begins to be too many executive communications that border either on the utterly reckless or the utterly mischievous, in which case it's frightening. So I think the response to that tweet is appropriate. It's frightening not just to Igbos, but to all Nigerians who really would not want a repeat of history. And it's really amazing, especially we got some news report about from Gazette about a memo allegedly being shipped to the president. It's really frightening, the quality of the brooding spirit around the presidency. This is the worst time in Nigeria. You want to have men with clarity of thinking, people with great moral strength to be in that villa now and help Mr. President steer the country away from precipice to some kind of negotiated peacemaking. But the country is really, this is a country that nobody can rule alone. This is a country, all this crisis means that the notion of authority in Nigeria, the idea that you govern the state by concentrating power and by displaying power is now nonsense. Nigeria can only be preserved in a collegiate, conciliatory, alliance-based power, what you can call socialism, meaning being put together with some level of shared power. This is what it's telling us. And you can speak, look at West Africa around us, look at Mali, look at Niger, look at Chad. Everywhere we are seeing that the African states, West African states, built around power, dominance of one group over the other, of all types, is why this is probably the most terrorized and fragile region, sub-region in the world, is the West Africa. And Nigeria imploded is going to make it far worse than anywhere in the world, including the Middle East. So we are really in time of crisis. I would beg Mr. President to probably consider diluting or changing his cabinet, changing his inner circle. Probably he's not as evil or as bad as these communications betray. But I'm worried about who is in that room, the brooding spirit. What spirit is incubating public policy, incubating public statement? This is dangerous and worrisome.
Thank you very much, Dr. Dare. Now, before I go back to my other guest, Chief DELE MOMODU, I would piggyback from what you just said. But do you think that there is any atom of provocation based on what is happening in Southeast today that may have warranted such comment or such statement by the president?
Absolutely. I think there is. I think the phenomenon of the unknown gunmen is something that should be discarded. That's my view. I mean, no president should allow police officers, security officers, and facilities to be destroyed the way that we are seeing the South. So whoever is that, the problem is that the mystery around the unknown government is the police has not helped. By now, we should be having definitive police reports on who is the unknown government. How do you come about it? So stop giving us video of people who have been killed, neutralized. The people who are dead do not speak a language. They have no identity. They have no communication. At this point, the nation needs to be hearing live statements of persons. So I want to put on record that we shouldn't have the notion of any Nigerian citizen killing officers. That's the right to do. I think that it is part of a total breaking of flag order. I mean, in the South, by the way, people, they play their worried. Nobody's worried. No, nobody's sleeping because they don't know who what is what. So the mystery around the killings. And now the government steps in. That's my worry. A government, the thing about government is that government is a legitimate use of violence. And that legitimacy is underscored by due process. So when government acts unlawfully, it's not like a government. So let's assume that there's some group called the unknown government who are acting in terror style, who are using private violence to attack the state. You would expect the state, like they do in the Southeast now, to start acting like gangsters, acting like criminals, shooting people at will, killing people. I've seen video, live video of related people, friends, journalists, who they call them, people who are in the shop with their sons, and their sons are killed. I've seen people who are taken, arrested, beaten and taken, and they're going to pay $1,200,000. So the whole Southeast is now a war zone. That kind of response to the provocation of the known gunmen and other criminal actions do not speak of a state. It speaks more as a terror squad. So in my view now, there are Southeast zone that is a terrorized zone. The state, police and military is acting just like terror groups. For example, the gruesome killing of our friend Gulag. Any gruesome, unnecessary, needless, and I have said with no business because actually there's no strategic value killing Gulag. Whether it's referendum you're looking for, restructuring, nothing. He is not important person in the shaping up of Nigeria in that sense. But that very silly, stupid crime does not require you to come in the next few hours to show us a picture of people burnt in a vehicle. That is terror behavior. So all of us are we see the U.S. We see people are shooting at the U.S. The government makes effort to get the criminals who are responsible as far as they can, publicly prosecute them and deal with them. So what we have in the South is that the criminality of those who are attacking police state institutions have drawn out double criminality from a state, and that's very pathetic because the only safeguard we have from ourselves that we have a state that should be neutral, objective, professional, and rule-based. But what we have seen in this government is that this government has collapsed to a lawless state. Basically, the kind of decisions we make, and that's why the IG statement is frightening. When you say, I am the human right, go and do whatever you like, how would people have confidence in that state even to stand up and say, this criminal or this group or whatever it is, don't arise us? The people are not left between the deep sea and the devil, and they will probably choose the devil because the state in Nigeria is like a double jeopardy. Again, finally, on this, the iniquity that 2, 3, 4, by the latest count, people killed, police officers killed, as of Friday last week, since January to Friday last week, in Imo State, is 14 people only, 14 in Imo. In Anambra, I think, either Anambra is 18, but the highest is Akwa Ibom at 22, by police report. Now, consider that and put it in context with those killed in the Northeast, Northwest, and North Central. Have we seen mass violence prescribed as a solution to those criminals? So this is the problem. We want Southeast to get back to where it is, a peaceful region. We don't want any killing of any ungodman killing or known guns to show that killing. We want to fight our battles the way we are fighting it, radically, having the right to express our values, whether it's for Biafra or restructuring. There's no crime in people saying they want Biafra, and nobody should be criminalized for that. But we don't want the state as well. So we don't want any unknown government killing people. But we don't want the state to use a pretext of unknown government to now carry out mass killing of youth in the South, because more killings happen in the Northwest, Northeast, and the Nigerian state has never given instruction to the police, say, kill. But we've seen them use human shield. We've seen them, communities, we've had statements of airmen being implicated as conniving with Boko Haram. We've not seen any level of military violence. So I want to see a state that's not a terrorist state, a state that says kill your citizens without due process is in all language and idiom of political science a terrorist state.
Thank you very much, and that's a very fine place to leave this here. So, Chief DELE MOMODU, I'm coming back to you now. Now, this morning, there was a report issued by the Human Rights Writers Association of Nigeria, Horiwa, and they warned President Buhari to forthwith stop reminding the Igbos, or rather the Igbo-speaking people of Nigeria, how he, Buhari, participated in the program that left over 3 million people dead. Horiwa, however, asked Buhari to stop threatening war against any section of the country and behave like a state man, except if he wants to tell the world that he is a warlord. Now, a part of that statement read, the rights group pointed out, basically, this, the Horiwa, that armed Fulani headsmen are being allowed to kill thousands of farmers, destroying communities, but Buhari allegedly pampers them and has never threatened to take war to their stronghold. Before I let you come in here, there was a this report, or rather a tweet again from the president, where when the Greenfield University students were kidnapped, he, the president, once more tweeted that he appeals to those who are behind this kidnap to please release these girls. Just opposing that to the tweet of yesterday, now with this allegation by Horiwa, what is your take, Chief DELE MOMODU?
Well, I don't think President Buhari ever tried to hide his mindset, no matter how retrogressive that mindset is. He would always speak his mind, and that's why I once told him that, look, once you are a president, you must have the temper and temperament of a president. You can no longer take sides. You must love every inch of Nigeria, and you must embrace every Nigerian, whether he is your friend or your imagined enemy. You must, that is the job of a president. There was a president in America not too long ago who loved to throw tantrums. But there was a limit to the tantrums. You know, and whenever he crossed the red line, people called him to order. You remember that it was the same President Buhari who said some part of Nigeria did not vote for him, so people should not expect him to be so generous to them. You know, and that, of course, created some controversy at the time. So it's still the same President Buhari now saying that he's ready to take war to the doorsteps of those we've battled in the past, because we know the language that they understand. For me, I sincerely hope that he will apologize for that error of judgment. I hope, but I don't think it is in his character to apologize for such things. But if I were one of his handlers, I agree with Dr. that maybe he needs to rejig his cabinet. His kitchen cabinet right now is obviously filled with hawks, hardliners, who are not ready to back down or back off any issue, no matter how frivolous. And that is very dangerous. We saw a man recently who was saying that the governors, the southern governors, have no rights whatsoever to stop any herdsman from wandering and grazing openly in the south. And you know that also generated a lot of controversy. So if you are being advised daily by such hardliners, it's going to be difficult to expect the president to be different from those who speak to him on a daily basis. His mindset, he has to do something by his mindset. He needs to do something. Yes, I remember again, he said he receives daily security reports. He gets good intelligence reports and all that. I don't think so. Because if the security reports have been very good, by now we would have witnessed some improvement. I remember when President Joe Biden came to power in the United States, the pandemic, the COVID pandemic, was still very, very volatile. And he gave himself a deadline. He said in the next 100 days, my first 100 days, we would have vaccinated 100 million Americans. And he actually surpassed that. So if after 6 years, you are still receiving briefings and nothing has changed drastically and positively, then the president should be more concerned about that than seeing his enemies in his sleep. You don't need enemies. You already have, Nigeria surrounded by enemies. So for you now to now bring in internal enemies, is it because what will happen is that if they continue to rain bullets on the people of the Southeast, then it means we're on the fringe of another civil war. And I remember reading, even as a young man, that no country can survive two civil wars. So why do we want then to encourage another civil war? It's not going to all go well for anybody, not for Buhari, not for Nigeria, not for the Indigo. So this is the time for all of us to come together, act together, and save whatever is left of Nigeria. I have never seen it so bad. I'm a 61-year-old man. I have never seen Nigeria this bad. And if we say we're not worried, every day people are calling us, what is going on in your country? We have friends who want to do things in Nigeria, and they don't even know whether they want to come or they don't want to come. It's rather unfortunate. So that is the thing. And then the president is also, for me, yesterday, what I read, the meaning I read to that thing again was that they are seeing, there may be some politicians. And you know, various governments in Nigeria had always blamed politicians for the problems of Nigeria. But if you say you have the security reports, then why are you afraid to pick up the politicians? Why don't you name and shame them publicly? That would have been more productive, if that's what the president is doing. Since you have access to the information that mere mortals like us don't, so why don't you then avail us of that privileged information? And the whole world can then know who the real enemies are. But for us to be, right before our very eyes, we've seen someone go in and out of forest to go and dialogue with bandits. I've never heard that government attacked the person. I've never heard that government invited the person to come and explain, what are you doing in the forest with those people, So this is why this is so sad. And what this has betrayed right now is that, then there must be a pathological hatred for the Igbo nation. And that's very unfortunate.
So your last statement, does it then tally to the comments, or rather a video that we have seen made by your good friend, the former Minister of Aviation, Chief Femi Fani-Kayode, where he said that one of the reasons he left the APC quick when he joined them during their formative stage was that in his one-on-one private conversation with President Muhammadu Buhari, he mentioned that President Muhammadu Buhari told him when he talked about equity, and he said, well, they killed our leaders, which obviously Femi also, out of basically being surprised, was shocked that a leader aspiring to lead a diverse nation like Nigeria could actually make such statement. So does that then confirm that probably that the president is somewhat still in the kind of in the memories of the war.
Well, I'm not privy to the discussions or conversation between the president and Chief Fanika Ode, but it's obvious from the gaffes that we have seen that the president, either directly or indirectly, is convinced that the Igbo people are his sworn enemies. That, I mean, psychologists can deal with that. You know, it's very obvious that he has seen the Igbo nation as his sworn enemies, and he is leaving no one in doubt that he is also ready to be their enemy, and that he's ready to tango with them. So, how that will pan out, I don't know, but for me, and for the good people of Nigeria, that is not what we want. We don't want war. And I'm happy that in the last couple of days, I've watched videos and I've listened to statements from Mazi and Kanu, even denouncing the spate of violence. I remember yesterday was talking about some trucks of onions that some people destroyed somewhere in the southeast, and he was angry that why would you fight people who are not fighting us? Why would you go and destroy? And he even promised that he was going to compensate the owners. I mean, and that should, if the president, and I've seen where people have even advised the president, reach out to these guys. If you can allow a Sheikh Gumi to go and dialogue with terrorists inside the forest, why not get people, there are people who can speak to IPOB. They are not ghosts. They are not ghosts. They are Nigerians. Whether you like them, you hate them, they are Nigerians. And I have one of my favorite Yoruba proverbs is that you do not set fire to an entire village because you want to catch a few rats. So if people get you angry to the point where you now destroy, you collapse an entire building, including your own children who are inside that building, is it because in a state of war? I mean, there is a Chinese proverb by Wu Qi that now the land of battle is a field of walking corpses. Those determined to die will live, while those who hope to escape with their lives will die. I read Wu Qi long ago. So in a war situation, you never know who the winner will be. And the next war, the war that you are looking at, is not the war of 1967. The war has advanced beyond that. Technology has changed. Okay? Everything in the world. So you may think, yes, I have superior firepower, we will rain bullets, but you don't know. America fought in Afghanistan. America, with all its might, fought in Iraq. We all know the results. So, and the worst thing that you can start is a guerrilla warfare. We don't need it. Nigeria is too beautiful a country. Nigeria is overblessed with some of the greatest human beings on earth. There is no country I've been in the world where I've not seen Nigerians doing great things. And I always say it, the president needs the Igbo nation. Igbo people are always liking them to a combination of the Japanese, the Chinese, the Indians, the Koreans, rolled together. There is nothing you will get in those countries that the Igbo man cannot replicate for you in Nigeria. You can have your own Silicon Valley in Abia, in Ebonyi, in Enugu, in Anambra, wherever, in Imo. Just show love. All you need is love. So this thing that, yes, the Igbos hate me, they did not vote for me, I will crush them, that is not what is needed.
Sorry, Chief, when you talk about love here, and you know, in governance, now, within the APC as a party, I was reading a report today where they will say that How can people talk about hatred when he is constructing second Niger Bridge, that the one that called himself their son couldn't? How can they say that he hates them when he is working on the Enugu Onitsha Expressway? How can he say that he hates them when he is doing the Lagos Ibadan Expressway that they use in going home? That is the type of argument I read today. So what's your take on it?
Look, I've heard all these arguments in the past, and for me, it's pure humbug. Yes, it is the duty of government to provide infrastructure. Okay? It is not a gift. That is the duty of government. And it is not true. Some of these things were actually started under Jonathan. Jonathan only spent 5 years in power. This government has spent 6 years. So if after 6 years we've never completed some of those things, including the international airport in Lagos, then there is nothing to boast about. You see, I just hate it when people try to overpamper our president. I was one of his biggest supporters. Till today, I'm still one of his biggest media supporters. Free of charge, gratis. I've never charged Buhari a dime from 2014 to date. On daily basis, because I am a good Christian. My Christianity teaches me render unto Caesar the things that belong to Caesar. I respect the office of the president. I will never disrespect the office of Buhari. Apart from that, he's old enough to be my father or grandfather. I will always respect him. And I've met him a couple of times. And it has always been in a very free flow atmosphere. So I have nothing personal. I want him to succeed. It is those who want him to succeed who are advising him. The real enemies, trust me, they are the ones telling him that he is God. They are the ones telling him that he is omnipotent. No president is omnipotent. God gives power. God takes power. You understand? Tomorrow, by the time he leaves, whenever he leaves, you will see the same people who are hailing him today. President Babangida is still alive. General Absalom Abubakar is still alive. General Yakubu Gawan, who led the civil war, is still alive. If you speak to Gawan today, I'm sure he will not remember that war with fond memories. It will be with sad memories. So, I agree with Dr. Sam Amadi that, look, we must encourage this leader to bring people who are clear-headed, not political jobbers, who are just looking for every opportunity to govern or rule Nigeria by proxy. They know that, I mean, at the president's age, there is a limit to his capacity to make things happen. So some people are happy to be acting on his behalf. I personally don't think that Buhari is totally bad. No human being is totally bad. And I look for the good in people. I don't look for the bad in people. I look for the good in every human being. I don't care whether you say you are my enemy or anything. You okay? Because if Buhari succeeds, then it means that I will be able to run my own business properly in Nigeria. If Buhari fails and Nigeria collapses, so of what benefit would that be to me? So I'm not one of those who wants him to fail. I want Nigeria to succeed so that everybody can do their thing. But unfortunately, it seems some people are hell-bent on dragging Nigeria down to Golgotha.
Thank you very much. And Dr. Sam, if you're there, let me come back to you. And this question will be specifically to you and your state. Now, there was a prison break in your state of Imo State. Reason why this question is very critical to you is that this is a state you campaigned vigorously to govern in the year 2018 and 2019. Now you campaigned to govern this state, and here is the state that every day you wake up, all you hear is it appears Imo State equals bad news this day. So you must hear one thing or the other that is negative coming from Imo State. There was a prison break, and the state governor said that they are working on unraveling those who are behind it. The police also made the same promise. But it's over a month now. There is nothing coming. No one, you know, we heard some say it is certain people. We heard the other say, well, it is political opponent. Over a month, nothing is happening. What can you tell us from your state, the state you once want to govern, what is happening?
Well, thank you very much. Before I came to this show, I was discussing with one of the leading human rights activists. The tragedy, the human tragedy, the deaths, the killing, the harassments, maiming in Imo State is beyond what we are seeing. We need to be there. People are calling me like every hourly. What shall we do? In fact, we had a program. Four of the people were supposed to come from Owerri 2 days ago. From the village, live in the village, to cross into Owerri. They couldn't come. Yesterday, I was a keynote speaker at NNAMDI'S event at Buhari here. Kanayo Okanayo was one of the moderators. He came in late. I said, he's from NNAMDI'S, close to the airport where that incident happened. He has to send emissaries to find out is the checkpoint free. He could have flown in a night before, couldn't leave over. So the level of siege in that city is unbelievable. Now, we'll talk about prison break. So far, the government told us that they have arrested over 400 of persons who have fought, 400 of criminals. We've seen many of the jailbirds, those who jumped the prison, come back. The police asked a week or a few days after the incident, they said they have rescued back about 100% of the inmates, and they're getting more for coming in. Okay. So clearly, prison breaks are not new. They happened in the door several times. But the difference in this one is that it's a prison break that was facilitated by violence against the center from outside. It wasn't a case of prisoners, you know, maybe taking charge and beating up their people. So it poses a big challenge as to safety of institutions. INEC, almost all the INEC offices in Imo State have been burnt, which brings another dimension. So clearly, whichever people are doing this are persons who have serious grievance against the institution. Until they kill the black, all this killing, there's no incident of the Imo citizen killed or any civilian or Bushan killed so far. He has been targeted, synchronized attack against the state, INEC, or police primarily. Okay. Second, the governor says it has protocol that the governor has said it's not Ipob. All this is political opponents. So the question is, what it tells us is that there's some political narrative in the state that probably is feeding into this crisis. For example, when the governor invited the Air Force, which is a no, nobody, during the SARS protest, the allegation was that the governor of Lagos invited the military to the Lekki toll gate that resulted in the killing. The governor swore by his mother that he never did. Even when the Brigadier General Commander said we were sent by the governor said, we didn't send you. What's the governor doing? The governor knew the dangerous implications of some chief executive claiming that he invited is actually unconstitutional. Deployment of forces in Nigeria requires a formal process of presidential declaration with approval of the National Assembly. Much of these deployments are unconstitutional, arguably. So for the governor to say that I invited Air Force to raid village, for me, a total political error. Even if he did secretly, because of security concerns, he shouldn't broadcast it. That was a mistake. What is he pandering to? So that, for me, is the moment in which political miscalculation fed into a crisis. We've seen Naira Delta, we've seen several crises. Imo was not the first place that, whether, even if it was Apple or any other group, even if it was them, which the governor says not them, it doesn't warrant the way the governor's poor response has made Imo State compound the security crisis. Look, I was part of loyal to Goni. I was cancer was loyal to Goni. With Gadefa and me, I can tell you, I was loyal to Oti. I was loyal who went to Sazanfara to sue over Sharia. Anywhere in Nigeria that civil disturbance, I invite the military. You have invited death. Fela was right. He says their original signature. It's a blood, tears, and sorrow. So when chief executives mismanage this security and bring the military and they become an army of occupation, extortion is happening every day. One lady, one of my mentees, professor of IMSU, last Saturday, she said she went on a road walk, jogging, and then she started hearing this staccato of shooting. She was panicking and she ran back to the hostel. And then somebody with a helot stopped her and said, calm down, helped her, carry her. There was a police officer. The man said, it's an SSS. And every day, they will go and invite them 400. The governor invites them. And they're not paying them. So now they are flooded the state with security people. We are not paying them. And these people are always angry, ill-tempered, with no experience from them. I worked at the highest level of security. So what do you expect? High level of brutality. So the problem is this. Those who attack prison are criminals. Should be found out. Like I always say, prosecutors, just like those who have bandits, those planning killers, henchmen themselves are bandits. They should be found out, prosecuted, not killed extrajudicially. Some of another people are always saying criminals are criminals. They forget that we have lived over 4 years under terrible planning bandits and killer henchmen. What you should do, criminals, is to arrest them. Don't kill a community because a few criminals are involved. Anybody who commits a crime, progress of killing police officers, deserve to have his day in the court, apprehended, jailed, and silent. But don't just take opportunity and deceive the people. If we have a chief of army staff, who is from Imo State, or IG from Imo State, will he give instructions to people to go and kill anything and there will be no consequence? It comes to me. He will not. So the dimension of this presence is that we are using the guys. We happen in Ogoni. I was with Chief Ferriwan in the office of Okutimu, and they rushed two boys and onto the ground. And Ken told us that must be Ogoni's. Every day, they would go, that time they would go and look at Ogoni people. They said, Nikon has matched their body. They open your body and see the cultural mark, they'll carry you, and you end up in Ogoni camp. Some died, some stayed months. So clearly, there's no excuse for criminality. But there's no excuse for state violence, state mindless violence. And what I think we should do is that when this crisis ends, we should probably open the biggest public interest litigation in the country, in Africa, where all the state governor, the state government, and the federal, all the actors, we will chronicle all those who have died. And let's go to the courts to show Nigerians whether there's no guarantee for life. So you have to bring a case to justify that Mr. X, or Chris Adam was sitting there, has shown a picture of two people for his village. Now take this for example. Our friend, Bilak, was killed somewhere between my Ngoban and my place, by the way, an airport. Obviously, it is not expected that people from that village killed that person. Now, if it is true, as the police say, they have wasted those who killed this person, it means that that killing could not be a village conspiracy. Why would they kill a man dressed in jeans and t-shirt? In fact, Gulag was almost unknowable, nondescript, incognito. A man who left the hotel to board a plane. So basically, if you now terrorize that community, we had that even with elementary policing knowledge. Anyone who commits a crime here will not stay 30 meters to 4 hours from that scene. They will disappear too far away. But if you now say, because it happened unfortunately, it's just like me in Abuja now, somebody is shot dead on my street, and in my study region. And because I live there, you take my wife, take me, take my children, take my brother who's just coming to visit me, and say, because we live close to the scene. That's not police, that's incompetence, highest level. So my plea is, for people from Gavana and those who are in those areas, spare them the misery and the deaths. They are not these criminals. The criminals you're looking for, look for them. Be painstaking, find them. But don't wipe off, terrorize some of people's children, widows. Well, their children are being killed every day. And there's no accountability. The biggest issue is killing people who may be innocent. How do you distinguish between the guilty and the innocent? It's the biggest estate. That's why law says it's better for 99 criminals to be free than one innocent person. Any state that kills an innocent man has a beyond cost of God. Because you should not kill an innocent person. It behoves you as a state to be painstaking. Why does the US spend billions, set up helicopters, tracking one criminal? And when they get that criminal, they prosecute him. Because you can't waste life. Criminals can waste life. A state can't waste life of the citizens. So for me, I have no excuse, no justification for the level of violence and killings of the service.
So okay, that's fine. But you know, coming back to my earlier question. Sure. Now, what you're saying is you are situating it. You're basically categorically saying that the Imo State and the police have failed in making this report public, if at all, or even concluding this report since those incidents.
Yes, I think there's been a lot of political speech going on. If the government says it's politically, I know the people, it's politically done. By now, they should have arrested some of political actors, which would have led to transparent trial. That's the problem. It's mocking. You say it's Ipob. Later you say it's not Ipob. You know, it's politicians. Who are these politicians? Do they have immunity? So for me, I'm totally against prisoners jumping because those criminals can terrorize the city. By the way, look, after this noise, the guns, the criminals, the everything, Imo and Southeast will suffer the brunt of it. Because criminals will be free, the rest of us. We don't want criminals. We want the state to be strong, a strong state that can find out criminals and punish them fairly. Buhari, what Buhari has done is that Buhari has made Nigerian state weak to biased policing. If you allow, for example, Fulani Hesman to move freely and no accountability, if you allow criminals to move, terrorists to move freely and no accountability, if we absorb them into the military without profiling and then they are about to watch their efforts, Nigerian state is very weak. That's why Ambassador Campbell and Robert Rodback of Kennedy School put a piece that Nigeria is actually like a first state. And indicators are very clear. Weak in effective policing is indicator. You can't protect law and order, indicator. You can't have a fair process, indicator. You have many, almost half of northern Nigeria is on governed space. Every day, they are kidnapping 1 out of 7 people on governed space, not of Nigeria. So this is actually a first state. What makes it more failing is a sense of injustice. A state has to be strong. And what makes it a strong state is a state to give justice to everybody fairly. Every criminal will have his day. Criminals in the East, West, North, you fight them. But a weak state arises in citizens. When a state now kills those who are not criminals, that state is actually a weaker than strong state. So what we have in Africa, not just Nigeria, are states that are weak. They can't maintain law and order, but they are capable of terrorizing citizens. We saw the answers. We saw what's going on now. What I'm asking for is a strong state that has capacity to find out, dictate, punish criminals everywhere, but protect innocent people from those criminals, not to further terrorize people who are already terrorized by criminals.
Can I quickly add something to that, please?
Yes, go ahead.
Okay. You see, my suggestion, and this has always worried me, is that the Nigerian police, the Nigerian army, should stop sending people of other tribes where there is a riot, a war. If it's already a known fact anyway that we have ethnic tension in Nigeria. The Fulani is opposed to the Igbo. The Igbo is opposed to Fulani. The Yoruba, the same thing. So if you send an army filled with Fulani soldiers to Imo State, you can be sure of what will happen. It's going to be a massacre. If you send the police, Fulani police, to go and arrest an Igbo, you know, Chief Sunday Adeyemo Igbo, who threatened to get rid of Fulani people in his area for destroying his fellow citizens. What do you expect? You will have a massacre. I think the government can do better. And that's why a lot of people have been conversing anyway for state police. That stop bringing it, and this has worked effectively in America, because you can't just see a police come from California now to come and arrest somebody in New York, or a police in Washington will go to Maryland, will go to Atlanta to go and terrorize anybody. Yeah, I think our biggest problem today is that the military has not left us fully. The vestiges, the last vestiges that we thought by now would have been obliterated, they are still very much around. I think we need to do something about it. It's either we want democracy or we don't want it.
Yeah, basically we are still suffering from military hangover.
That's all. No, no, if even if you look at it, the 1999, who took over from Abdulhamid Abubakar, a retired general, General Olusegun Obasanjo, who took over from Obasanjo, brother of an army general, you know, Umaru Musa Yar'Adua, brother of Sheikh Musa Yar'Adua, and then he died in power. They brought in Jonathan temporarily. They kicked him out. Who took over? A general, 8 years. We don't know who is coming next. So the military blood in us is still overflowing. That's the truth.
Hopefully, we will not go down the lane. My prayer is that whoever is going to be Nigerian president again would never be one who experienced war, because the mentality sometimes can be very worrying. Now, Chief Dele, now that I have you here, the tweet that we talked about at the beginning was taken down today by Twitter, because it appears, as it were, people did not only complain amongst themselves, people took action. Twitter took down that tweet, saying that it violated their community guidelines or community rule. And after the fact meeting today, the Minister of Information, Chief Lai Mohammed, made the following statement. Can we have a listen before I land with my question?
The mission of Twitter in Nigeria is very, very suspect. As Twitter deleted the violent tweets that NNAMDI'S Kanu has been sending, has it? The same Twitter, during the NSAS program, that was funding NSAS protesters, was the first to withdraw, to close the account of a former president of US, Trump. And you see, when people were burning police stations and killing policemen in Nigeria, during answers for Twitter, it was about the right to protest. But when a similar thing happened on the Capitol, it became insurrection. You see, we are not going to be fooled by anybody. We have a country to rule, and we'll do so to the best of our ability. Twitter's mission in Nigeria, citing those two examples, is very suspect.
Okay, so now as you said towards your closing statement regarding the military, even Alhaji Lai Mohammed said that their job is to rule. He didn't use the word govern. There is a difference between governing and ruling. Now, this is a minister of information saying to the nation, to the whole world, that their job in Nigeria is to rule. Now, this is one question to you. I want you to basically, I think I would also want Dr. Sam, coming from, trying to interpret the language usage here. That is one question. The second question is, it appears the federal government has issues with Twitter, because even the almighty Donald Trump of America was yanked off Twitter, was banned from Twitter. But here, it's a president of a nation had this tweet that everyone considered so annoying and so unnecessary that people complained and Twitter took it down. What do you make of Alhaji Lai Mohammed's statement, Chief DELE MOMODU?
You see, let me give you a background. That's something they taught us in literature, you know, in the literature class. It's called the sociological approach to literature. I am very troubled about that statement made by the Minister of Information, because he's a man I regard as my big brother. We were very close when I was in exile under Abacha. He would never enter London without calling on me. I'll go to his house, and I know that he's an extremely brilliant man. Is he? I don't know what happens in government, because I've not been in government. I believe he's trying hard to do his job, to justify the position he currently occupies. But I know he could do better. We used Twitter. I, DELE MOMODU, used Twitter, used Facebook, used Instagram to attack Jonathan in favor of Buhari. We didn't attack Twitter at that time. We didn't see Twitter as enemy of Nigeria. When we were working to bring Buhari to power, nobody ever complained that Twitter was our enemy. So I'm shocked that, so whenever something does not favor us, then we must begin to see ghosts where they don't exist. It's unfortunate. The truth of the matter is that the world has moved beyond where you can have one man rule, where a dictator can do whatever he wishes or likes. That's what happened to Donald Trump. Did they not suspend him indefinitely? The most powerful president on earth was suspended by Twitter. The heavens did not fall. So if we want to ban Twitter from Nigeria, ban Facebook from Nigeria, ban everybody from Nigeria, so let's continue to live in our village. If that's the level we want to reduce Nigeria to. So let's continue to live in our village and let's tell the world. So it's very easy for us to run to Paris to go and have a meeting with the French president and some leaders a few weeks ago. So if the world was not a global village, if the world was not important, then why are we wasting our time to go to all those meetings at the United Nations? We must join other nations in advancing the cause of humanity. Nigeria cannot continue to live in a cocoon of stupidity and backwardness. That's the truth. And that includes accepting the truth. Yes, of course, Twitter is not infallible. Twitter is not our idol that we must worship. But it is so obvious that Twitter has its rules and regulations. Every organization has its rules and, you know, so they tell you, you cannot do so, so, and so. There was a time, my account on Instagram was being investigated. And I made sure that I complied with every rule. And when I complied, I wrote to them and they made sure that they restored everything. You must obey the rules. But in Nigeria, we think the same gangsterism we use there, we can extend it to private business. These people make more money than the entire continent of Africa. You can't bully them. What happened yesterday, reminding us of the Nigerian Civil War, it was a sad day for Nigeria and for Nigerians all over the world. If I were the president, I will apologize and say, I'm sorry. It was an error. I am frustrated with the insecurity in Nigeria. I am sorry. It does not cost anybody to say I am sorry. Because if and when tomorrow comes, you would regret that you did so much damage, wittingly or unwittingly. Thank you.
Thank you very much. You know, that's a very, very brilliant one. And Chief, Dr. Sam there. Are you there, Dr. Sam? Doctor, are you there to, can I extract your response to this question? Can I extract, Dr. Sam, can I extract your response to the, you know, the Twitter removing the tweet by the president and the Minister of Information responding in the manner which he did?
I think the Twitter deleting the president's tweet is not a major attack at all, because it is common for tweet. Even Trump does this, sometimes they flag his statements and say unverified. So Twitter has several tools. And for this particular one, the statement that I'm sure must have deleted maybe thousands or millions of reports to Twitter. And typical of Twitter, they will arbitrate some kind of quasi judicial process, look at the statement, compare it with their standard, and see whether it's offensive. And so, having compared, they said that this was an offensive speech. And they have not yet banned the president. So, think about if they did like on Trump. But again, the Minister of Information, as a government spokesperson, maybe we should cut him some flags. He has to respond. And like the president, Twitter is not a god. Many people have issues against Twitter. Twitter can also sometimes cut us off and complain. So I don't feel bad, but the idea that, for example, you mentioned NNAMDI Kanu's tweet. Very simple. Twitter is not grandfathering NNAMDI Kanu or anybody. If enough people report any tweet that it's a tweet that is mobilizing violence against a people, then I think Twitter will probably delete it as it were. So this is not a case of Nigeria, where we assume that some important person, Twitter is now part of a particular ethnic or sectional group or part of a political movement. Very soon now, they will accuse Twitter of working for PDP. That's the way we put society in a genuine manner, some of these issues. But a serious thing I feel is that our brother, Muhammad, very smart, like I said, but oftentimes the government spokesperson sometimes can play dumb, let this move on, because basically there's nothing we'll achieve by saying Twitter is against Nigeria. When the case spoke also, it's against anybody who criticizes the government or raises issue around policy or approach of governance, like, is probably against government. So what he's saying, that look, Twitter is suspicious in that he has flagged the Lekki killing and the role Twitter played with NSAIDs. He didn't know that, also mentioned that Twitter played similar roles across the world, whether it's mass mobilization or democratic accountability. So it wasn't like Twitter focused on Nigeria. It's a platform for democracy to push the boundaries of accountability. And so Twitter responds to some of those things based on the sense that it should enable, it shouldn't be enabling tyranny, it shouldn't be a tool that maybe dictators should use, and it should be a tool that facilitates openness, which is the ideological basis of digital technology, create openness, close down borders, open the space, and create accountability. So basically, what they have done is that they have applied accountability to President Buhari. It's interesting. National Assembly never applies accountability to the president. The courts, sometimes, I'm a lawyer, is afraid of applying accountability to the president. There are many things we've gone to court challenging some executive actions or executive speech. National Assembly will not say, we condemn this statement. Twitter has helped us to say, this statement is unpresidential. This statement is not even proper public communication. This statement should be withdrawn. And like Bele said, maybe somebody or the press could have said, well, I didn't mention this. I've seen President Biden, even Trump, many presidents of the world say, come back and take their words back and say, look, that's not what I meant. I simply wanted to communicate that we can't control with insecurity of this dimension. And I agree with the president. We need to, you know, be stronger on crime, be stronger on insecurity. So if you have said something like that, say, look, this is what I meant. I made a mistake, and I'm very sorry.
Profile
him as, you know, like African leaders, Nigeria, but they think that being humane and compassionate and speaking to your citizens degrades you. Maybe it's this Emirates conception, leadership. You know, you are you are a king, you are emir, you are obi or oba, you are eze, and therefore you don't, it can't be wrong. And therefore, even if you're wrong, you bluff your way through, you know, or you boast your way or key your way through. It would have been nice to say, look, this has been a great moment to say, I'm sorry, my friends from Southeast. I'm a friend of the Igbos. I'm a friend across the country. I'm doing the third major bridge. I want to open up the Southeast for economic development. I love the people of this. Even if you don't believe me, it's good, patient speech. I didn't mean this. Everybody will say, well. So I think the notion of conspiracy and keeping this strong man's mentality that you need to offend, and the more you offend people, whether you mean it or not, the better for you, is what the logic makes me actually.
So what you basically just said now, I would add, isn't it akin to expecting a chicken to urinate?
I think they say Buhari, probably that's why he has 10 million locked votes in his locker, because he has a mistake, his Buhari can't change. But again, see, I think either it's, if he can't change, then he's not supposed to be leader. That's number one. Leadership, JFK says, learning and leadership go together. So if a leader has reached where he can't learn, he shouldn't be a leader. And by the way, it might be that the only problem I have today is Buhari, unfortunately. People love him, but that's the only problem. And I guess if he exists or resides or finishes his tenure, I may not be dealing with this level of insecurity. Love will flourish. It will be like taking the genie out of the bottle to discover that Nigerians love themselves. You will see insecurity disappear. He is actually unwittingly probably the incubator by mannerism, behaviors, this I cannot change. Look at appointments. It doesn't really matter in normal times who is the chief of army staff or police. But in normal times like this, those gestures can tell the eyes. It breaks the barriers. So our problem today is that we have a president who is not the best for this hour. The French we need is a president. He might be weak, he might be effective.
A unifier.
Somebody who can speak to others, who can connect, who's humane. So we are cursed at this moment.
Well, thank you very much. I think we are coming towards the end of this of this program. But before we do, we've basically looked at several issues, especially from yourself and from Dele. You know that a lot of issues has been looked at now, but you know it would be nice to walk away with some solutions. This hopefully will be published, and hopefully the president will listen, and those that are in charge will listen. But they read, you know. If my good friend Asukwa can probably, since the president likes cartoon, and takes the solution and put it in form of cartoon for him, probably to find and digest, that would be also be very helpful. Now, I'll bring back Chief DELE MOMODU again. Please, if you can come back now and give us your closing, you know, shot on this. What is the solution that we can see in all this that the tweet has generated? Moving forward, what is it that you think could help us to calm the tension that we see in the land as we speak?
The solution is not difficult at all. When I met with the president in 2015, I told him I was going to appoint myself a special advisor from outside, free of charge. And I took everything, all the advice I gave President Jonathan, I compiled it into a book, and I offered it to President Buhari. He even requested for my autograph. I signed it for him. And I promise I will do the same thing for him. And I've been doing the same thing week in, week out, in Pendulum, on the back page of This Day, and in our own online newspaper, The Boss. But the truth of the matter is that I don't think this government is willing and ready to change its ways. They are so rigid, unbelievably rigid. What Nigeria needs to be, everybody knows, is love. That's number one. You need a leader who can unite the country, not a leader who will look the other way when his own people are doing things. That's why I said Look, if President Buhari was interested in being a Fulani champion, then it would have been better to be an emir. But once you become a president, you lose the privileges of an emir. So today, he must see himself as the father of the nation, and he'll be able to douse the tension. Then two, he must begin to communicate with the people. His taciturnity is so, so bad. Even one of his biggest supporters, there was one woman, I saw a video I posted this morning, I can't remember. She said, the Yaloja of Abuja. You know, this woman said, look, I am a fanatical supporter of Buhari. I support you. I have no regret supporting you, but talk to the people. Imagine if a Buhari fanatic is saying that, then it tells you that something. And the only time the president will speak was yesterday, because we didn't even know what was going on, to the extent that people were even doubting his existence, like René Descartes, you know, the philosopher, you know, a situation where a man begins to doubt his own existence, you know. So, and yet, the man did not talk to us. And the only time he spoke yesterday was this crisis or scandal, because it was a scandalous speech. So, number one, he must show love to every part of Nigeria. Number two, let him remove kill and go soldiers. If we need soldiers anywhere right now, it's in Sambisa Forest, not in Anambra, not anywhere. Then let each of the regions, okay, do something. Let the leaders of the regions come together and prefer solutions from, an outsider cannot dictate. Or you understand, in a federalism, you cannot bring outsiders to come and tell you what you can do and what you cannot do in your own state. I believe that the leaders of Igbo Nation in particular, they have been terribly weak. Extremely weak. They have over-pampered Buhari. Now, fortunately, unlike in the past, Buhari cannot say he does not have APC governors. They have APC governors. But what are they telling the president? We don't know. So maybe some of them, because of their own personal ambition, are even encouraging him to do some of the things he's doing. You may not know until much later. So we need to know what the leaders are telling him. Again, you need a leader who does not see service as a favor. A service is not a favor. It's your job. The president is employed by the good people of Nigeria, and he must serve them, and he must not talk down on them. And when they tell him, when they challenge him, when they query him, he should take it as part of his duty and responsibility. He needs to be calm. And then I think doctor suggested that he needs to change some of the people around him. The ones who are there right now are behaving like hogs. They have become too powerful. They have become uncontrollable. So everybody is speaking in staccato voices, you know, like they are untouchable. They are unreachable. And they cannot yield to any form of advice, no matter how progressive that advice is. I think that is what we need. Nigeria can do a lot better than we're doing right now. But there is too much violence, there is too much vile, there is too much bile. You know, everything is upside down. And nobody is trying to even drag us back away from the precipice and say, no, we can't go this route. Let us return to our path of sanity. Thank you. And good night.
Thank you. Thank you very much, and it has been a very wonderful time with you. I appreciate the time, and, you know, obviously, you've given more than I requested, and I do appreciate that. Thank you very much. Thank you.
Thank you.
And Dr. Sam, thank you very much. So, Dr. Sam, are you still there?
Yes, I'm here.
Okay, can I extract your parting shot as well? You know, what's your solution to what is happening?
I think there's a technical solution, which is better law enforcement, but it's a political war, which is reach out to people. I mean, look, forget all the stonewalling. President, the governor, can reach out to every group. We can de-escalate by using best of goodwill to reach out to people. There are issues that are driving these conflicts across the country. Some you can settle, some you cannot settle. So why don't we try some more effort at dialogue? The Southern governor said, President, initiate a dialogue. If you create today, tomorrow, the President announces a national dialogue commission made up of credible Southeast, Northeast, Northwest, Southwest Nigerians. Credible. They say 10, 12. Say lead out dialogue on Nigerians on whether it's infrastructure, whether it's referendum, whatever is the issue. Let's discuss. Chile has had a referendum to start an entirely new constitution. So some of the demons we are afraid of in this country are not demonstrating. They may have the caricature of demons, but inside they're not demons. Conversations. Let's discuss. The things that separate us are not as much as what unites us. Interestingly, if you look at this structure, then if you reframe it from zero-sum game, from power take from the south to the north, it's clear that the northerners will benefit more from the structure. And now they are signing up. People are saying, well, it's not a bad idea. So let's remember that a country, a nation, yes, it's true that Nigeria is a failing state, say, or a failed state, whatever it is. But every state is a construction. It's a social imaginary. You can create a better state. What we need at this moment is focusing less on kinetic approach, fights, shooting. He has not worked. Like I told you, I was loyal to Ogoni. When Ken was being tried, and Ken was the hangman's court, military tribunal, it has not solved the Nigeria crisis. It didn't solve the Ogoni crisis. We wasted blood. Nigeria was banned from the Commonwealth. Canada moved. We lost a lot. But still, we still needed an amnesty from Yaradua, a great leader, if not that he was assailed by illnesses, a leader who understood the history. So that amnesty helped to minimize the crisis in the Yaradua area. And so the point is that Yaradua knew that it's not just about shooting your way to victory. It's talking your way through. I was a member of the Yaradua Special Committee. In fact, the first Yaradua summit that was proposed by Yaradua with Gambari, now the chief of staff to the president, was the chairman. I was the secretary designate because of my experience in the Nigerian Delta. So that resulted in some reduction of tension. Leaders, the modern state is a talkative, it's an argumentative state. You must engage with these people, you must argue with them, you must try to win their hearts and minds. Make effort to win hearts and minds. And that's where appointment, symbolism matters. You see, symbolism matters. Think about President Buhari campaigning and wearing Ishiago and wearing all those dresses. Now think about Buhari now today. If he wears Ishiago and goes to Afi, and goes to where, and goes to where Yoruba State, and go to Yoruba States, travel across Middle Belt as a president in the same symbolic dresses was, it would go a long way to cement relationship. That's where President Obasanjo probably and Jonathan, score higher. Symbolism, modern state is communication. Look at Biden going to Tulsa to make that great speech, to tell the black communities that we understand how the state has ruined you. It's the equivalent of the president broadcasting over the entire and saying, Nigeria, we went into a needless war. We recognize that we erred in killing ourselves. Today, we affirm to every Nigerian that together as humans, we will restore our dignity and work as one, Nigerians, and build a nation. We are even the supply of rest. They have opportunity to express their oppression and get reprieve. If that happens, it goes a long way. So the notion that we can still keep Nigerian genie under the bottle through authoritarian strategy, dark art of government, it has failed. What will keep Nigeria going together is openness, sincerity, and the willingness to affirm every Nigerian and accept those who have wronged and willing to make amends. That's what we should learn about modern governance. Great leadership is not about a dark act, killing, maiming, arresting, manipulating, sending memos to strangulate freedom and human rights. It's actually about opening the system, showing that you care, connecting and rebuilding. So I think we can get rid of this. But look, we have to match the firepower of the security force with more than the firepower of good communication, of good symbolic things, of respect for everyone.
So thank you very much. That's a very fine place to leave it. Once more, thank you for joining me. My guest this evening have been Dr. Sam Mamadi. Dr. Sam Mamadi, thank you very much. And Chief DELE MOMODU here, a man I have so much immense respect for. Thank you very much once more for joining me. And in conclusion here, before I let you go, now there is an article written by Ademola Olateju, or basically Bamidele Ademola Olateju, and he said the following. He said that time is running out to make Nigeria work as a unified entity. The truth is that Nigeria has learned no lesson from its civil war. The forces of self-determination are too strong to be tamed. They have grown bigger through many years defined by frustration. Nigeria will not work until there is justice and every region is allowed to eat what they kill and decide how to develop at their own pace. He went further to say, the rise of ethno-nationalism in Nigeria is not a fluke. It is not driven by the elite. It is a bottom-up thing, fed by the disempowered. It is real and ferocious in fervor. The emergence of Sunday Igboho and the growing strength of the indigenous people of Biafra are indicators of building political movement. Now, that is on that plank. On another plank, I have here the following words by the Afro Senator, that is the Senator Shehu Sani. Who said about Nigeria with fairness? Justice, and to treat all Nigerians with fairness and justice, as long as we would continue to run a nation and a system where collective punishment is meted on people because of their political decisions or history, we are simply emboldening the secessionists and their sympathizers. Love, again he said, love those who hold the national flag in order to crush those who reject the national flag, so that our great country can withstand all subvention. Once more, it's a very fine place to live it. I could not thank every one of my guests enough, and everyone who tuned in this evening, and those of us watching online. It has been a very good time spent, and the solutions are here. We can only hope that those we are proposing the solution would even get a time and a chance to read them. We hope that eventually they would do the needful. On that note, I will thank you very much for joining this conversation this evening. Once more, thank you.
Thank you so much, Mazi Ezeoke. Thank you. God bless you.
Thank you. Thank you, Chief. I have stopped the recording now.
So. Recording stopped.
Anything we say now
is off. No, I have to. It's past my dinner time, and I haven't had anything to eat, you know, most of today, so I need to go and at least grab something.
Thank you very much, Chief. Honestly, I appreciate your time.
Thank you.
I appreciate your time.
Thank you. God bless you, and goodbye. Thank Dr. you. Sam Mamadi, thank you, sir. Nice seeing you.
So I would now, while my guests are leaving, I would now allow those, the participants here, if you wish to say a word or two. I think you can now unmute yourself if you so wish.
Okay. My friends on Facebook, I can never thank you enough. Oh my God, we had over 2,000 at the time, 2.4, there about 2.5. That was huge. And my friends on Instagram, thank you so much. And my friends on Space, Twitter Space, yesterday we were talking about Twitter, and here you are. I just said, let me try this. Let me see if I can just bring in one or two people before I go off for my dinner. Let's see. Okay. Why? I'm trying to get someone to speak and it's not. Okay. Spaceman, I think you are now able to speak. Please go on. Hello? Doesn't look like anybody is ready to speak. Hello. Okay. Mr. Muiwa, if you can hear me. Good evening, Mr. Muiwa. How are you? I can't hear you. Are you able to project louder, please? I'm hearing you, but it's still quite faint. Maybe you need the mic very close to you, please.
Okay, the mic is, can you hear me now?
I'm hearing you, but it's a bit faint, yes. Yeah, I'm hearing you, but yeah, it's just that...
Can I speak on?
Yeah, please go on. Thank you. Yes, I also want to thank you and all the listeners for joining me. I know some are at work, some are at home. They should be resting at this time. But you see, we all love our country. Wherever two or three Nigerians are gathered, you can be sure they are discussing Nigeria. Well, anywhere in the world, that has been my experience. But it's so unfortunate that our leaders and not making enough effort to unite the country. Because you can't unite a country if some people feel like second-class and third-class citizens in their own country. I don't have anybody I can call my enemy. I have Fulani friends, I have Hausa friends, I have Tiv, I have Yoruba, I have Igbo. So if we all go to mosque, we go to church, and we still harbor hatred for our fellow human beings, then something is wrong somewhere. So I want to thank everybody for this opportunity. I need to run now. I just wanted the situation where at least I can speak to some of my friends on space. Thank you so much. God bless you. If I have the chance tomorrow, maybe we'll do something again. Thank you and good night, everybody. Bye-bye. Thank you. Thank you. Wow, thank you, thank you. Facebook is incredible. Thank you. My friends on Instagram, thank you so much.